the hospital here, and that's where people come. It's amazing that a country as rich as ours, we literally have thousands of people living on the streets. And what's amazing about that is, what passes as normal, what passes as sane, is to walk over them and drive by as if you don't see it. So, living in New York, as I have for the last 12 years, you often see mentally ill homeless people on the streets. I mean, we're one of the few countries in the world that allows mentally ill people to live on the streets. And you'll see people talking to themselves or shouting, and other people ignoring and walking by. And I sometimes wonder, who's really crazy here? The person talking to himself or the people walking by acting like they don't see it? What has come of us that we see that now as normal and acceptable? I start with this because part of what I'm going to raise to you as students who get to go to a lovely school and receive what I would imagine to be a first-class education is, I think you have to ask yourself, what does it mean to be an educated person? What responsibilities come with that? If the only thing you aspire to is getting to the best college possible, then you're selling yourself short. Real short. There was a Holocaust survivor who wrote a letter to teachers. And in that letter, the survivor says, "Dear teacher, I am suspicious of education. I am suspicious of education because the doctors who tortured us were well educated. And the engineers who designed the gas chambers were well educated too. And so were many of the other nurses and technicians who kept these camps going." And then he goes on to conclude, "Any education that is not rooted in values and ethics is an education that will produce more Eichmanns." And Eichmann is an interesting character because he was just in the paper, New York Times last week, a letter that he had written to the judge in the Nuremberg trial saying that although he was responsible for many of the concentration camps, he should not be held liable because he was only following orders and therefore he should not be put to death. And it was such a profound letter to see in the papers after so many years because it raised again the question, what does it mean to be responsible? What does it mean to be educated today, this time in the world? Education is always about two things. Always. It's about learning the things you need to know to participate fully in society, right? So to get a job, to have the skills, right? To support yourself, to function. That kind of education, that part of education is essential, otherwise you'll be unemployed. So it's, anyway, I'm a practical person. I have kids of my own, I want them to get an education that leads to them getting jobs, them being able to take care of themselves. But education also has another role. And that is it must enable this generation, you guys, to have the creativity, the critical thinking skills, the problem-solving ability to solve the problems you're going to inherit. And you're going to inherit a whole bunch. You got global warming, that one's coming to you guys, right? You got lack of sustainable energy, right? They're related, right? Especially now oil prices are so low, so now what are they doing? They say global warming is an advantage, now look for oil in the Arctic. We got huge suffering because of poverty, exacerbated by global warming, the drought now in Africa. We got wars all over the world, and now because of many of the actors are stateless actors like ISIS, we have enemies that we don't even know where they are, where they could be. We got diseases like Zika virus that are now scaring people away from going to the Olympics. I don't want to depress you, but this is the world you inherit. And that's the reason why we not be afraid. To look at them as a challenge that needs to be solved. Now that might seem like a lot, doesn't it? Except we have examples of individuals who have done precisely that throughout our history. Who have done more than simply say, I gotta get a good job and a good house. Who use their creativity, their intellect, to make the world better for other people. How many remember Ebola? Remember Ebola? Just 2 years ago, their prediction was that Ebola would be a pandemic. They were predicting that it would spread from West Africa and be across the world, that over 1 billion people would have contracted Ebola by December. Today, Ebola is almost eliminated. Almost entirely eliminated, including in the countries where it was first originated. How did that happen? Well, at a time when others were talking about quarantining people who'd been there and not allowing people from there to visit their countries, and in New Jersey, the governor, Chris Christie, running for president, actually quarantined a nurse so that she had to live in a tent because he didn't want the virus to spread. While there were people reacting that way, there were others who said, you know what, we got to go to the crisis, not run from it. One of them was an epidemiologist at MIT, Dr. Fala, who happened to be from Liberia, who happened to be from the neighborhood in Liberia called West Point that was the epicenter for the virus. He said, I got to go back to my home community. And he didn't go back with a vaccine, because there is no vaccine for Ebola. He didn't go back with the latest modern medicine. You know what he went back with? He went back with an understanding that the only way to counter the disease is to rise beyond the fear, to organize the people about how to handle the sick, to build trust so that people work together rather than running from each other. It was the singing of a child sick on the ground and people afraid to touch him because they thought he had the disease. People like Dr. Fala and many, many others, Doctors Without Borders, went to the crisis without a vaccine and stopped the disease spreading. Now a lot of people died, but the disease is gone. I bring that up because, and I can bring up several other examples as well, because we have those examples of using knowledge, using our intellect to solve big, complex problems that at one point seem intractable, seem unsolvable. My challenge to you, as young people who are getting a good education, who are preparing, I know there are a lot of seniors here, these are the seniors they go to the front rows, who are preparing to think about the college I'm going to go to, what am I going to study, to aim higher than simply think about what good college I'm going to go to. What good grades I'm going to get to. Think about what kind of difference you want to make. What kind of impact you want to have on the world. How am I going to use the many privileges I've had in my life to benefit others who have less? It's only when we realize that we are in fact interconnected, interdependent, that the world is still one world that we've got to live in and share. It's only when we have that kind of consciousness that we start to make a difference in the world. I'll tell you one last story, then I'll open it up. How many of you heard of Jane Goodall? Jane Goodall, the climatologist Jane Goodall now, the global warming activist Jane Goodall, the human rights activist Jane Goodall, said she got her start at age 5 studying animals. She used to go into the chicken coop and sit there for hours, because she wanted to know how the eggs got laid. And instead of her mother being freaked out that Jane was staying in the coop overnight, her mother asked her, tell me what you saw. Tell me what it was like. Her mother became her biggest advocate. And so as a child, her interest and love of animals grew, and she became this keen observer of animals. She read Tarzan books. So she became fascinated, preoccupied with the idea of going to Africa and living amongst gorillas and snakes. So she told her mother, at 18, she went to the university. She said, I want to go study gorillas. And the mother said, that's too dangerous for you. You're only 18. You can only do it if I go with you. She said, okay, let's go. So she and her mom go together to go study chimpanzees in Kenya. And they're living in the rainforest, and she's out there observing. She gets malaria during the course of her work. It takes a long time for the chimpanzees to get comfortable with her, but eventually they do, and she starts documenting what she sees. And she shares her notes with the most famous archaeologist in the world at the time, Richard Leakey. And he sees what she's doing. He's so impressed. He's the one who discovered the first human remains in the Serengeti Plains. He says, you don't need to get a bachelor's degree. You should go back to your PhD. You already got the bachelor's here. Go to Oxford. He writes a letter, and because of his recommendation, she's admitted to Oxford without a bachelor's degree. She goes to study primatology there, but as soon as she starts sharing her notes with professors, they say, this woman is crazy. Because she thinks chimpanzees have personalities. She thinks that they're like humans. And she's dismissed. Except one of her faculty says, I want to go there with you to see what you see. And he goes, and he spends some time with her, and he starts to say, guess what, she's right, they have personalities, they make tools, they do lots of things, they're a lot like us. And then he says, you know what, you have to translate what you write into a language that the scientists can understand, because they can't learn from you if you write about their personalities as though they're humans. You have to talk about that. They act like humans, not that they are almost like us. So he helps her. And she continues to study gorillas. And as she does, she becomes aware of the fact that many of the people who live near the gorillas are deforesting the habitat because they need wood for homes and for fuel. And at first she thinks that they are her enemies, and then she realizes the only way to save the apes is to save the people. And the only way to save the people is to save the planet. And so she makes these connections, and now she, at 84 years old, is a world-traveling crusader for the environment, for animals, for people. I share the example because we have many of those examples of people who've been able to use what they know for the benefit of others. And through their actions, make the world a little bit better than it is now. My challenge to you is to aim high, not to settle. To imagine possibilities of what you could do with your own talents, with your own gifts. I hope that is something that appeals to you. Because the world needs another generation that will commit itself to tackling the problems before us. So I think it's time for some questions or comments or reactions. So the floor is open. Aren't those people? Anybody? Yes. Okay, the question was, somebody came from the projects and all that. What's my opinion standardized testing? My opinion is that assessment is necessary. We have to assess students as they learn. The way we do now is totally inappropriate. We largely assess students to rank them. We don't use the assessments to help them, which is how we should use it. And I would say that we use assessment as a weapon, and we should use it as a tool to help kids, help schools, but that's not the way we think about it. I would also say that when education becomes so focused on the assessment, on the score you get, whether it be the state test or the SAT, that the value of the learning experience is diminished. And that's true whether you go from the projects or whether you go to Westminster. It's like thinking about losing weight. You think focused on getting the best scale you can and weighing yourself as often as possible, or do you focus on getting good exercise eating well? We don't focus enough on that part of the education. question was, what made me want to study sociology? A lot of it was my curiosity about the inequality I was exposed to. When I got around, surrounded by, it was old money, right? If you go to, the Brown brothers were slave owners and slave traders. The school was built in the early 1700s. George Washington stayed at on College Yard in the building the president uses. It's an old institution. I was alienated by that when I first got there. Seemed so far removed from my experience. And then it raised the question, okay, how come I'm here, but so many others are not getting this kind of opportunity? What does it mean for me? How does our society allow these kinds of unequal opportunities to exist? Why? And those questions, I didn't realize until my sophomore year, were questions that were really central to sociology. Because I didn't know what sociology was before I got there. I just happened to take a sociology course. And here's the other thing that happened to me when I took that course. The course was taught by what I would describe as an absent-minded professor. This guy had on those kind of glasses that had bound to the side, because his eyes moved and you couldn't tell if he was looking at you or not. This was at a time when professors still smoked cigarettes in class. So sometimes he would write on the board with his cigarette rather than chalk. And most people thought this guy was just a nut. Because I asked a lot of questions in class, he started taking interest in me, and he became my mentor. And because he became my mentor, he opened doors for me that I didn't know existed, which is critical. It was both that he had the interest in me, and I had the willingness to be mentored that allowed that to happen. So, yes?
Common sense has to be cultivated if it's going to lead to real wisdom.
And I think that's something that you have to take ownership for yourself too. Yes. Question was, what's the most rewarding product I work on during my time as a professor? Good question. I can think of the one that came right to my mind is when I was most recently involved in working with schools in the townships in South Africa, just outside of Port Elizabeth. And I'll just briefly describe. This is a school in a very high poverty area, a school where many of the kids are orphans because their parents died from HIV. And despite all the hardships and all the disadvantages, it's a thriving community. It's a thriving community. And not because it gets a lot of money. It's a thriving community because the principal they assigned to work at the school, who comes to this school that's just barely functioning, decides the only way he can get this school to operate is by organizing the community and supporting it. And so he brings in, that each day they have about 100 parents who volunteer, don't get paid, who help out in different ways, including growing food on the land so the kids get fed. And then you even have parents who volunteer for the homes of kids who are orphans to cook for them and help take care for them about that. And what I found so rewarding about that experience is the collective agency I saw that was making results. The people were not waiting for the government to save them. And they weren't simply protesting. They said, we will take responsibility ourselves for creating the kind of school our children deserve. And that was inspiring me to be part of that work. Yes? Okay. The question was, what do I notice in my students at UCLA? Are they too aware that they can inherit all these problems? And so what are they doing with it? I would say it's very uneven. I would say there's a whole lot of them. Their anxiety is not about the state of the world, it's about the kind of job they'll get, right, when they get out. That's what they're anxious about. It's understandable, because that's how they've been socialized, and they're feeling that pressure. Occasionally, though, I meet students who are thinking bigger than that, and who are imagining how to use their education and have a bigger impact. So I would say those are still the minority of students that I am. And that's unfortunate. So.
Do you guys need class?
I'll be here. I'm going to ask you.